guys went to the Gunpla panel this morning at 10. This is nothing like that.
Be prepared to actually learn something.
This will be in English.
Yeah, no translators.
Nate might need a translator.
You realize that one in the morning was a commercial for Bad Night Sunrise, right? This is a commercial for us.
I see a lot of people that I saw last
week. So, welcome to the... you guys have your wristbands, right?
Who was here last year?
18 plus. Let's just say 18.
Yeah, it does. There we go.
Just kidding. Now, any of you guys have been to the 18 plus, look at your mom's kids. I don't like her already. She's well practiced at home. It's tomorrow night. It's usually our first one, but this one's tomorrow night, so it's a lot of fun. You're gonna learn the same stuff.
Tomorrow you're gonna learn some other things.
Second slide is shameless plug. Now, purpose of this is to promote you guys to build better and to compete. One of those things we do is we've been hosting this contest for this is gonna be our seventh year, and it is the biggest Gundam model contest in all of the United States, North America, hands down. I mean, even adding up all the GBWC competitions, we beat that, sure, by numbers, right?
This is true.
Yes.
All right, shameless plug over. So, we have a commercial for you guys. So, some of you guys might recognize how some of you guys build like this. Let's see if we have audio. We want you to hear this. This is hilarious.
We were a different kind of nerds, and we did not hang out with the AV club, so.
Don't want to hang out with a bunch of nerds to learn more skills.
Masking is hard.
Who got this rule and pay attention?
There has to be an easier way to get parts off these runners.
Shut up, Timmy. Time to level up your skills at the Southern California Dental Model Competition. Check out all the helpful panels. Like airbrushing, deco application, weathering, and more.
Here at SCTFC, we teach you to be competitive, to beat everyone, so that you can win one of these coins, show them off to your friend, and say, I'm better than you are.
I built this, and it's thanks to SCTFC.
And now I'm rich, thin, good looking, and there's an awesome Mercedes out in the driveway.
What?
Okay. Now, after attending SCGMC for 2 years and watching all the amazing panels, I'm an awesome model builder, and all my models win contests. Thank you, SCGMC. You're the best.
Southern California Gundam Model Competition.
We've been doing this panel for like 10 years now. So some of you guys have actually been to this panel for 10 years, I don't think. Still We're going to go over some basic skills. We're going to go over what SCGMC is. It's actually a Southern California Gundam model competition. And we're going to go over some more advanced stuff. So, those Gundam guys. Dan, Angel, Mike, and Nate.
Thanks, Nate.
Siblings.
So, recently left Nate.
What?
Incidentally, we just got notified that he won the Best of Show at the DBWG like half an hour ago. And he's not drunk. After you feel drunk and you finish the stuff, you're just gonna look at your kid and go, whoop. This is Dan. This is a couple of the kids he built. You see him standing next to Kawaguchi, and he took this picture in Hong Kong, right?
Yeah, now like everybody has this picture, but at least for like 7 years, only I had that picture.
No longer so.
Some Angel's kids that he built.
So that we're talking a little bit about that. Major scales of Gundam models are the smaller 1/144 scale, generally considered high grade, you get your master grades at 1/100 scale, your perfect grades at 1/60 scale, and the big boy is the mega size at 1/48 scale. It's also a common aircraft, less common tank scale in terms of other scale models. I thought the Mega's line was dead, but they just released, or they're about to release the Mega Unicorn, so that's pretty cool. Okay, so there's a lot of different lineups and grades. And they come from a bunch of different TV and manga series, mangas like comics. So, three of them, the RG, MG, and PG stands for Real Grade, Master Grade, and Perfect Grade. These are very partsy models and generally feature an internal framework like mechanical robot skeleton underneath the armor. It's all right, I like it. So, this is a perfect grade, but in terms of all three of them, you definitely have very good color separation, meaning that the parts are molded very finely in all their different parts. The modern master grades are pretty amazing in terms of, you know, the tiny little bit of red plastic that goes inside the base or whatever to just make it a separate color from the rest of the face. They're getting very, very good at that, where they're even, I guess, like laser cutting little holes so that you can see through the armor and see like the mechanical frame underneath and all of that. And if you are going to paint your models, that's still very useful, because when it's all separating the different pieces, you can paint this piece red and that piece white and that piece blue, and you put them all together and they're the right color. Whereas, you know, in the bad old days, there would be like one piece of plastic and you had like paint white, mask off the white parts, paint blue, mask off the blue parts, you know, paint the red. So it's really made life a lot easier. Exterior detail is usually very good. Although in the Masquerade, it has kind of gone through stylistic changes, so like in the 2.0 era, like the Masquerade 2.0, had a very cartoonish, like very slab-sided exterior that didn't have a lot of detail. Like the 3.0, on the other hand, is like a little, like a giant wheel rig with like tons of little stripe lines and kind of color separations on the exterior surface. One thing about these lines is they are pertsy. So you're gonna open that box and get a whole lot of plastic, you know, hundreds of pieces easily. So how pertsy are they? What? Hands off me. I just assumed it was eight, you know. All right, so this is a real grain Zaku. Next to, and these aren't as common as they used to be, but this is a, you know, box of cigarettes, which is what, like the size of a deck of cards? Look how small that thing is. It's about 4.5 inches tall. Next slide. This is the number of parts that goes into building that little kit. They're full of parts with tons of engineering and color separation.
Not including the separation for the frame.
The frame's already built. Now, to some extent, those frames are somewhat pre-built in that, like, the arms are one piece, the legs are one piece, the foot is one piece. There's probably a few parts on the leg of that one. The next line is traditionally, I thought it was high grade. They also have, that's usually 1/44 scale. And I put the HGXX because it used to be the main line was HGUC for Universal Century. HG stands for high grade. But now they have HGAW and HGAC and HGBF and a bunch of other ones. They're same basic lineup, but different series. They also have the mega size kits and the no break kits and the reborn line. So these kits have good color separation, but not quite as good as the master grade or real grade. And they tend to be simpler. Generally, they don't have an internal frame. Some of the newer kits from Iron Blood and Orphans do have an internal frame. This is not quite as intricate as that of the master grades. The reborn ones, they're fairly new lineup. If you wanted to kind of try out your hand building a kit, and especially when you try painting it, this might be a good place. If you start with a master grade, you might have less problems with masking and so forth, but hundreds of pieces, it can be kind of intimidating and kind of a slog to get through. This is kind of a good middle or starting point instead of in terms of high quality, but not so many parts. So here's an idea of, you know, in comparison, there's no real robot internal frame. There's like an ankle here and a knee here, but there's not like all the parts in between. And even that frame is just some sticks. It's not like a whole bunch of moving parts that slide over each other and enclose each other. Do you guys know what grade that is? It's P-Bandai.
I've had this image up here for the last 10 years. I've been doing this panel. Nothing has changed. We still start with basic plastic. We still go up to primer, base coat, final coat, shading, and whatnot. So all these steps are actually optional. You can stop wherever you want. You can stop at bare plastic if you want. You can actually jump around to different steps as well. So certain things have consequences to that, but for the most part, when you're building Gundam, you can do whatever you want. flipping parts. Generally, if you look at how this is clip off the trees using nippers, you're not getting. How many of you guys still use nail clippers to do this? You guys are awesome.
Oh, I saw that.
He
went halfway up and he realized he should probably raise my
People still, I mean, when I was growing up, I used nail clippers because I just rummaged through my mom to make up boxes. Ruined her tools.
Who uses God hand clippers?
We're robbing him later on. he has five of them.
You've only got two hands.
So he has a God hand there in the packaging that he's keeping forever.
Yep, all five girls God hands.
I have some bridges to sell you. So when you're clipping parts from the tree, what I did was I clipped really close to the part. And when I sanded it down, you have that white mark on your part. So how many of you have clipped parts and sanded it and you still have that white mark on there? This is why, because you're flexing that plastic. When you bend it, and take the runners and bend it back and forth, it'll turn white because you're stressing that plastic. So what you want to do is you want to cut away from the part. Like so, what I did was I cut away from the part a little bit and then I sanded it down. And then you can see that those marks aren't white after I sanded it down. A little bit darker, but still better than having those glaring white marks on there. Seam lines. How many of you guys know what a seam line is? So these Gundam kits have, this wonderful box art, right? Especially the high grade kits. And you look at them, you're like, wow, this is cool. And then you get them out, you cut the parts out, you put it together, and it looks nothing like the box art. You have these lines that run down the middle of your kit, and you look back at the box art, it's like, there's no line here. I've been lied to, right? And those are called seam lines. I'll show you really quick how to fix them. It involves applying glue, which is just your standard styrene glue. It melts the styrene together, and clamping the parts down, and letting it sit there for a couple hours to overnight, and then sanding it away. So this is what it does when you add the plastic cement to it. And you glue it together, and you squeeze the parts together, you're going to have this plastic ooze that comes down the middle. It's because you're basically welding the part together. Once you sand that off, it's completely gone. How much better does that look? Just sanding it off and having it just that bare plastic. It looks so much better. Build a portion.
Anybody has any questions, by the way, you guys can ask at any time. Just raise your hand.
Please ask questions.
And we will answer.
What the heck is that?
What is wrong with you guys?
Roll.
Why do you fly doing this?
They're the old and only together. All right. Build approach. So if you're going to actually paint your models and try to make seam lines and do it right, you're going to have to think about, how am I going to go about this? So you got a whole bunch of parts in the box. And you got to paint them and put them together in some kind of order. So let's go through that. Okay, so the first thing we're going to do is snap the entire model together. And then we're going to have to take it all apart for the most part to paint it. So when you put it together, you want to clip off these pins. Because if you don't, you put the parts together with all that friction, you have a very hard time taking them back apart again. Another thing you can do is on the opposite side, this is the male pin, like the female side, you can take the X-Acto knife and kind of bore that hole out slightly so it's not quite as tight. Either way, that allows to have just enough friction to hold the parts together, but not so much that you have to break them to get them apart again. Okay? Another good thing about snapping it together first is you can look at places where you can. I actually have some a couple years ago, Ben, I gave some out at the Double Build Bulldog Competition here. They look like swag bags for people to enter. So that's the thing, it's not quite the same as that Martin's Lego tool. It's a blue one, but the same idea as a little plastic wedge. That helps. You can also use your X-Acto knife, but it's just way easier just flip down. down the things and not have to, you know, wedge them apart. I mean, with some kits, with all the parts you put together, you would spend hours taking them apart and probably really jacking your fingernails in the process. And that little plastic tool, the one I have, is pretty tore up from all the time I've had to go in there and wedge it, because it's not that much harder than the plastic you're pulling apart, so it gets kind of messed up over time.
So. The new ones don't have that one. Same.
In general, we glue our kits together as well. So when we're doing this, the pegs are there for pretty tight fit because they're designed to be built without painting or glue. But for the purpose of this, what we want you guys to do is move beyond snapping it together and go on to gluing, go on to painting. So this is the reason behind that.
So in terms of painting and color separation, there are some parts that, for instance, these two parts of this lower arm would have gone around this piece with that big pin in it. And that pin would have trapped in what at the beginning was a complete circle. So there's no way to paint the gray parts separately from the blue parts. So what I did is I cut a portion of the circle out into more of a C shape. So that becomes like a clip-on kind of thing. So then I can build this blue part, do the seam line work, paint it, and then when I'm done, I'm gonna snap it and pop it into this part. So that saves me some work later on. So that's another thing to look at when you're snapping them up. Modifications you can do to paint the parts separately and put them together after you paint to save yourself some nasty. So I'd rather spend an hour or 20 minutes cutting that thing apart than spend 20 minutes masking. Masking's not a ton of fun.
Yeah, as you seen earlier in the video.
Masking is hard.
Okay, another thing to look at, mobility mods. Not so much a problem with the newer kits. The newer kits are pretty ridiculously poseable, doing like their poses and everything. But in the old days, like the original Master Grades Aku, the farthest it could like pose with its legs open without modifying was like about like that. You know, that's about the best you could do. And you know, like the Aku 2.0 could be like this, you know. So there's things you want to do to a kit before you start painting it to modify it. So in this case, by adding this peg here, or adding this plastic to set this peg further down, I gave myself some more room. So here's an unmodified part, here's my modified part, which allowed to bend at almost 90 degrees, which is a big improvement over what the kit allowed. So here's some more mobility mods. This is the Zaku I talked about. Again, I added a peg to lengthen it, which gave me more clearance, which let the Zaku have a wider stance. So again, stock on the right, modified on the left. Another thing you can do, shave down bits of plastic in strategic places so they're not banging into each other, so you get a little more clearance in your joints, so it gets more room to move. Finally, you can just literally make a joint where none exists, insert like an aftermarket polycap or a spare polycap from a kit into the middle of your model and give that torso some mobility mod. This is an older Master Grade kit that didn't have any of that. So by cutting the pieces apart and putting a ball joint in the middle, then it's allowed to do this kind of thing.
Okay.
One issue with all the mobility moving that, you know, like guys who build airplanes and tanks are about to deal with is moving parts can scratch paint. So a lot of the kind of more pro modelers kind of pick a pose and paint it in that pose and don't really try and change it. Another thing we like to do is use lacquer paints.
Yes.
So we do like lacquer paints, even though they kill your brand cells. It makes you dumb. And I have more brain cells. Because they're very tough. The solvents that make them kind of dangerous, and we work respirators, and we use airbrush fumes to kind of suck up out of the room. Sorry, Mike. Eventually, I'm going to get to my point. The solvents that do make it more dangerous also let them suddenly eat into the plastic and kind of permanently bond themselves chemically to the plastic, which is very tough. So you can get acrylics, you can literally take your fingernail and scrape your paint right off the surface of the plastic. It just sits on the surface of the plastic. This stuff suddenly melts its way into the plastic. So as you rub the parts together or whatever, so nervous. I put the parts together, and I touch each other and scrape, and I scrape paint off. Now it's like the lacquer that like scrapped it. Oh, perfect. Yeah. Question in the back.
If you can't hear me, man, no, it's okay. But if you do use acrylics, does top coat help?
I mean, technically, the more layers you put on, the more layers you have to scratch through so you see damage. But, I mean, I trade one layer of lacquer for like five or six layers of acrylic.
It's not way
You can paint it and throw masking on it. You can paint it and go, oh, I got some lint on it. Turn it aside for 5 minutes, pick it back up, sand it, and keep painting on it. Whereas if that happened with acrylic, it's like, oh, I got a problem. Well, let me put it aside for 20 more hours at least before I can do anything to it again. So that's another reason I don't like acrylic. Wow, my own panel is leaking as I'm talking. I am tanking up here. Now, aside from like the toxicity issues in the community, you get ventilation and a respirator, I don't see any downside. They're helping bond beautifully, and they're durable. I think they're great paints. I love them. This guy got me using them, and I'm like, I'm never going back. So. Yes.
So, I started using lacquers first, and I actually donated all my acrylic paints to that bald guy right there. He kind of still
uses
them, but he
has
seen the light.
I don't know if my brother-in-law's here. That's where I donate money. Wow, thanks for supporting me, guys. All right.
Video.
All right.
Never watch the video. Ooh, ah. I did the audio too.
Like, okay, I'm supposed to do that talking to
you. Well, it's pretty halfway here. There's a little bit of dark blue. I'm going to appreciate this. This is my first layer. So I'll have some in my airbrush. And we'll get ready to spray. Get a test. Change my pressure a little bit. And my first spray, I'm gonna spray a distance. Notice the distance I'm spraying. This is to get a quick mist layer. Now once I'm done, you can see here, small little dots of mist on the surface. Once I do that, I can go on with a heavier layer. What the mist layer does is allow paints to stick to the surface. Otherwise, you're going to have a problem with the paint pulling. So I'm just spraying here just to color the entire part. Notice the distance my airbrush is at with the part. And notice that it's nice and wet, it's glossy, so I'm done here. Now what I have here is a bottle of black that I'm going to be using to spray the other part. So I want to make a comparison with pre-shading with a dark color versus a blue tone. So it's the same part. But I'm going to do the same thing as I did with the blue, because I'm going to spray at that distance to get a mist layer. You see this? Nice light misting layer, so there's just little dots on the surface to help the paint stick. Once I have the little dots on there, I can go in closer and spray heavier. Now, the nice thing about this gloss is you spray fairly heavy. With some practice, you can get a nice wet coat, and it's ultra glossy. Again, notice how close I am spraying to the part. These parts have dried for a little bit, and I'm going to spray the same color over both parts. same way, and you'll see a difference between the two. So first, before I do anything, I'm going to do a miscoat as well. So again, same thing with painting it earlier, and you need a miscoat for the paint to stick. Otherwise, you have run into a problem pulling. Now, for pre-shading, you get really close to the part. You see how close my airbrush is to the part. And with enough control, you're spraying the center areas, the center flat areas, and then you move on to the next area, like I did now. So again, spray the center areas and keep the edges dark. Now, pre-shading is a matter of preference, how dark you want to shade it, how light you want to shade it. So again, I'm just going around to the part and shading bits and pieces here and there. Now, once I have this done, this is really darkly shaded. Now, what I want to do is I pull back from the part and I'm blending. This is basically the same technique as misting. With the misting, the lighter areas in the center are getting even lighter, and the edges are also getting lighter, so you get that light fade, and you're blending the color together. You see that there's slight shading, and again, this is a matter of preference. I prefer a lighter shade. I'm going to do the same thing with the black part. Again, spray from a distance to get a light mist. Once that's done, you see that I have a little light blue dot on it. Get in really close and spray in the center areas. Now you can also drop the air pressure down a little bit so you can get even closer. You're going to have to play with your air pressure and distances to get this right. So again, notice how close the airbrush is to the part. And when I'm spraying on the black part, you see how the tones are showing up. You see the edges are really, really dark. Now, once I get this done, I'm going to pull back and I'm going to mist to blend everything together. And once I have this blended together, I'll have the part painted. So now I'll be able to compare this piece with the other piece.